meant for an adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content.
Loveline, viewer discretion advised.
Welcome to the show we call Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. This is the good doctor, Dr. Drew. He's a board-certified physician. He's an addiction medicine specialist, and he is a purveyor of Swedish erotica.
I don't know why I put myself through this sometimes.
Why? For the paycheck,
yeah,
Drew.
Right.
Same reason I'm here. All right, but I would be here for free tonight. Do you know why, Drew?
Why?
Because Everclear is coming on.
Good guys.
Yeah. So, as per usual here on Loveline, we will be checking in throughout the evening with Trish McGaha, our lovely correspondent. She is in Las Vegas.
Hey, guys. How you doing? Nice to see you.
But first, Kenny on the Loveline phone. Kenny, what's your problem?
Yeah, I smoke pot about 5 times a day.
Great.
I heard this rumor that was going around that if I smoke too much, that I could actually grow breasts. Is this rumor true?
It's not a rumor, Kenny. Particularly for adolescent males around 13 to 15 years of age, marijuana will actually increase your levels of estrogen in your blood, and some males will experience breast development.
And at 5 times a day, it's time to start shopping for a training bra.
Yeah, it's a problem. I mean, Kenny, this is serious addiction. I mean, for anybody who questions whether marijuana is addictive, how long have you been doing it 5 times a day?
5 months.
And do you remember the first time you smoked pot?
The first time?
Yeah, the very first time you got high smoking pot. People typically don't even get high the first couple times they smoke it.
I was about 14.
What did you think about pot the first time you got high?
Oh, I loved it.
I loved it. And interestingly, I loved it is exactly the statement that many marijuana addicts will say about their first experience with pot. Not it was great, or I was kind of relaxed, or it kind of was fun. It was, I loved it. It was the best thing. That is somebody that is going to be preoccupied with that drug every day from then after. You may not smoke it every day from there on in, but you'll be preoccupied and pursue it and ultimately be smoking it every day and be like Kenny, smoking it 5 times a day. You'll do that for somewhere between 1 and 20 years typically after that.
All right, so Kenny.
Yeah.
All the bad stuff you've heard was true. If you're not too baked right now, please absorb the information that Drew has imparted upon you. And just relax a little. Go out and kick a soccer ball around, would you? Thank you, Kenny. Now, as promised, we talked about them a little earlier in the show, and I'm excited to see the guys again. They are Art, they are Craig, they are Greg, they are Everclear.
Great.
Howdy,
boys. Getting comfortable? Oh. Now, you guys are in the studio now, right? Yeah,
making a new record.
When is that due to be released, you know?
Next September.
And because Sparkle and Fade's been, what, May 95?
Yeah.
So it's time.
Yeah,
it's time.
Much.
But,
yeah.
You know, it's had a lot of longevity. I mean, not that it's that old, but what I'm saying is you know, they're still playing the songs. You guys are still playing. People are still digging it.
We're done. We're not playing anymore. We just toured Australia, and we're done.
All right. Now, you guys also did something for the Romeo and Juliet soundtrack.
Yeah. Did a song called Local God. Did you guys see that movie?
Yeah.
Number one at the box office last week. Who'd have thought? Yeah.
Wow. Did you guys see it?
MTV. Yeah. Of course we saw it.
I don't know. You guys are big rock stars. Oh, really?
Yeah. MTV meets Shakespeare, and it's
working. Classic. As in all official functions, you know, our limo pulls up, and there's all the paparazzi and the red carpet.
Paparazzi. This guy reads People magazine.
And the limo door kicks open, you know, and we strut out, and we're all looking good, and everybody's like, who's that?
Well, we ran into each other in the bathroom at Radio City. No, everyone's pants were up. This is the Radio City Music Hall for the MTV.
That's right.
Video Awards.
You never told me about
doing
that.
This, and I said it would never fly. It would never get off the net.
Now you're cursed because you're here. All right, you guys are going to help us with some of these calls.
All right.
Ronit, you're in the audience. Where are you?
Okay, I have a question. I was in a relationship, two relationships, one for 5 years, one for 3. Both of them were abusive relationships. My question is now I can't allow myself, if I go out on a date, to me to kiss a guy is like a big deal. I can't go any further than that. I've been intimate with only two guys, so what kind of advice can you give me on...
State your question more specifically. Are you looking for ways that you can...
Looking, right, to
where I... Open yourself to intimacy more?
Yes.
I'm not sure you should. I mean, it sounds like your judgment is getting keener and you're being more careful about how you conduct yourself in relationships, and you are appropriately questioning your judgment. You wonder if you're going to get involved with somebody who's abusive again.
But so, Drew, you're saying lock yourself in the apartment, call the good folks at Meals on Wheels, and subscribe to some cable station. No, call it a life?
No.
The woman has to date. She has me.
Right. Gentlemen, go ahead.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yes.
And she's very attractive.
Go ahead.
Yeah,
she is. Now, wait a minute. I'll finish after you guys are done.
All right. I'm done.
That's what I figured.
No, I mean,
what do I think?
Yeah.
I know how you feel. I mean, I think your instincts are going to tell you what to do. You need to just take your time and just take your time and not worry about it. Not worry about any kind of time limit. If you meet someone that you feel comfortable with, even if you're a little nervous, make the jump. But try not to go towards the same people.
It's because you've had some bad experiences and you have learned from them. And so now you're questioning your judgment. You're being very careful about who you develop a close connection with.
Right.
And that's totally appropriate.
And you got to look into your past a little before you met these guys, your upbringing, your relationships in the family and all that, and figure out what led you to these abusive guys in the first place. Because if you can sort of look into that and clear up that mess from the past, then you can go on and have a fruitful future.
Thank you. Thanks.
Yeah.
Right on. Yeah, what he said.
I was going to say the same thing.
Fruitful fooper. All right, Rhonda, you're on the Loveline phone. She punched
Hi.
Up?
Yeah.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. My boyfriend, he's in jail right now, but before he left, like the day before, he cheated on me. And I didn't find out until after he was already in jail. And now we have phone sex about 2 to 3 times a week. I'm wondering if am I being stupid for waiting for him, or should I just get on with my life?
All right, first off, forgive him for the indiscretion, because having sex before you go into prison, cheating on someone before the day you go in, is just it's akin to trying to get some off the stewardess while the plane is going down. He thought maybe it was his last chance. He's going into the big house now. He's going to eat all that cream corn. All right. So how long is he in, Rhonda?
He's been in for 7 months, and he'll be in about 2 more months.
Uh-huh. And in between phone sex, do you ever have any just conversation? You ever ask him why he cheated and what the circumstances were?
He told me it was because we weren't getting along. But, and plus because he was on drugs. But I don't see that as being no excuse.
Where is he when he's having the phone sex? I know he's incarcerated. Is there some sort of... phone booth with black velvet put over it? Or where's he during this process?
He's in the phone booth out in the hall.
Whoever's on cleanup detail at that prison.
Is he doing what you're doing at the same time?
Yeah.
He is. Okay. And that's okay, huh?
I guess, because he doesn't get in trouble.
Oh,
no one's caught.
Well, I'm not worried about trouble. I'm worried about getting beat up.
No. I guess nobody sees him. I don't know.
Yes, not.
All right. So, Rhonda, do not break him out of the can, but keep in contact with him. If he comes out sober and he's committed to you, then you can take it from there.
Insist on some involvement in recovery immediately, and if not, terminate the relationship. It's going to be a nightmare when he gets out.
Okay? All right.
Okay.
Thank you. All right. Well, now, as promised, we're going to check out the Pictel system with our field correspondent, Chris Magaha, who's in Vegas. Chris?
Rhonda, by the way, you should just dump the guy and just move on. Get a really nice guy like Rod here, who's 24, from Indiana. I believe he has a question for you guys. Go ahead.
Hi. How you doing?
Good. How you doing?
All right, here's my question. Here's my girlfriend's a reporter in South Bend. And whenever she comes home, I get the brunt of all of her bitching. She's a great girl. She's nice to everybody. When she comes home, I take all the punishment. I'm just wondering what I should do about that or how I should handle it.
I say you hit the strip and pick yourself up a hooker.
Great advice, Adam.
The end of Vegas.
That's right.
But I'm not sure I understand. Is he saying that she is terribly stressed out as a result of her career, and she comes home and dumps it on him?
Yeah. I guess it sounds like a relationship to me. You need to just talk to him and say, look, you're dumping on me. I know you've had a hard day. Let's talk about it. Talk about it with me. Don't talk about it at me. It's a relationship. That's what it sounds like to me. Or you can go get a hooker.
They got all those ranches, you know.
And there are ways that you can empathize with her without having to be abused by her. I mean, you're not a punching bag. And let her know you're there and you want to listen, and you'll take a certain amount of the trying to take off some of the stress and to take on some of it for her. But you're not going to be abused, and don't allow that to happen.
All right.
All right. Thank you, Chris. Brian, you're in the Loveline audience.
How's it going?
Pretty good, thanks.
Cool.
My question is, there's this girl that lives across the street from me. We've lived there for about 8 years, and we've never really done anything with each other. And one night she came over to my house, and we started having sex, and my condom broke. And so my question is, what is the best thing to do immediately after such thing happening to guard against pregnancy?
Move to Kentucky. No, please. Well, we'll answer this seriously with Drew with Everclear after this.
At 213-520-LOVE, 213-520-LOVE.
Back with Greg, Craig, and Art, all from Everclear, and Dr. Drew, and myself. When we left off, we were speaking to Brian, who's out in the Loveline audience. And Brian, he had this neighbor, lived across the street.
Still does.
You basically just were friends with her for like 8 years?
Well, actually, I never really spoke to her, but I only started talking to her probably in the last year.
Uh-huh. And then you guys finally had a sexual encounter and your condom broke.
Yeah, that's right.
Right, because it's been sitting in your wallet for 8 years.
which is a good point. I mean,
I like the way he says it, though. She lived there for 8 years, she came over, we had sex, and my condom broke. It's just like, was that it? Was it like a big deal? I mean, when it happened?
I was totally stressed out. You know, because like it's the last thing I need to get a girl pregnant, so I'd rather not do anything with her.
There actually is something you can do. I don't know if you guys are aware of this, but there's basically a morning after pill that you can acquire easily. A medication called Loveline, which is basically just an oral contraceptive pill, can be taken as two pills each day for 3 days, and that has a pretty reasonable result in terms of preventing pregnancy post event. There is also two medications that can be given in combination that will sort of abort, which is really what this causes is doesn't allow implantation at least. And then RU486, which is an abortion pill, may yet become available in this country.
Drew, how long after the incident can you take this?
You've got about 48 hours.
We'll see what I'm actually.
Drop the mic and run, you fool!
What I'm actually wondering is what can I do like immediately after like a condom breaks? Like I've heard of urination would help.
No. You can get yourself to a doctor, get that contraceptive pill, take it the way it's supposed to be taken for post-coital contraception, it's called, and that's what you can do.
Yeah.
Okay?
And don't get my partner wrong. If you gotta go, you gotta go. It's just not gonna stop the pregnancy. Thank you, Brian. Jennifer, 20, you're on the Loveline phone. What is your question?
Yeah, hi. I freebased cocaine for the first time the other day, and my lungs and my abdomen just really, really hurt. Now I want to know if I did any permanent damage to myself.
Are you okay today?
Well, it still kind of hurts, but it's better than it was before.
Did you have a lot of coughing?
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys ever... You,
Yeah. Well, my big thing when I was doing coke was shooting coke. You know, freebasing to me was like the sissy way out of it.
Yeah.
From the macho, stupid posture where I was at as a drug abuser 12, 13, 14 years ago. But, I mean, I've seen people, like, this was back when I was still doing it. People, the crack hadn't really happened yet. The
right.
whole chemical change.
Right.
It was still a freebase. And it's a whole different world.
Well, freebase is sort of harder to cook up and harder to deliver. Crack is actually stronger than shooting intravenously. People don't typically do recreational crack. If you're delivering that drug in that way, you're gonna get addicted to it in all probability. What tends to happen, it can cause a lot of irritation in the bronchial airways, you get a lot of coughing, and the pain can come from the rib musculature, from the cough, and from the tightening in the bronchial airways. People do get heart attacks on cocaine. In fact, when I was in training, when somebody under the age of 30 came in with a heart attack, I didn't even ask whether they were doing cocaine. I knew that's what it was.
Happened to me.
You had a heart attack?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. The last time I shot up, I was, I guess, 22, 23, and I tried to put almost 3/4 of a gram into my arm at one time. My heart stopped, and I woke up with the EMTs pulling me out with the defibrillators.
And I don't want to leave people with the notion that people have that happen to them only with large doses of cocaine.
No,
even just snorting a little bit can cause that to happen. It causes constriction of the vessels that supply the heart muscle with blood, and it actually causes stickiness of the clotting factors in the blood, so the arteries constrict and the clot forms in those arteries. They can be devastating heart attacks.
So Jennifer.
Yeah.
It's good you're in pain. Hopefully it'll stop you from doing it again.
But as long as you're feeling comfortable today, you ought to see your doctor, obviously. I worry about the cardiac possibility here. But if you're comfortable today, you're not having any further pain, you're not having any shortness of breath, you're certainly okay at this moment, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Don't get into it,
guys. Go to hell, man. But, you know, the sad thing about it is some people just have to learn on their own. It's just like, I mean, I had so many examples. My brother died of an overdose. My brother-in-law drank himself to death. He looked like he was 65 when he died at the age of 40.
Yeah.
You know, it's just sad. And some people have to learn the hard way.
Our culture makes light of addiction. It is a disease like any other disease.
It's an ugly disease, man.
And if it has a treatment, I mean, that's the message I keep trying to give out.
Look at me. I'm alive, man. I can't believe I'm alive. People who know me.
Tom on the Loveline phone. Let us hear you.
Adam, Drew.
Tom.
Hey, I just want to let you guys know at the presidential election, I voted you president, Adam, new vice president there, Drew.
Thank you. I'm running on the bra platform.
The bra platform.
Next time.
Legalized bras, huh?
What's your question?
All right, guy. It's been about a year and a half now, and I've been having dreams about men. I've never been gay, as far as I know, consciously, and it pretty much only happens in my sleep. I was wondering if that's normal, if, you know, what's going on with me here? Because this is not right, and I feel kind of weird about it.
All right. It does not mean you're gay, but we will give you the answer after this break. Computer, you want to contact us? Here's how, girl.
Email us at loveline3@aol.com. That is loveline3@aol.com.
All right. More Loveline, more Drew, more Adam, more Everclear. When we left off, we're speaking to Tom on the Loveline phone. Now, Tom said he was dreaming about boys. Tom?
No, men.
Oh, really?
Only
oh, that's right. I was dreaming about boys during the commercial.
Tom?
Yeah.
Go right ahead.
All right, man. They've just been weird dreams, you know, and it's only when I'm sleeping, and I don't have the same feeling like when I'm awake. Like, I even had a dream with Marilyn Manson in it. Now, I think Marilyn Manson's a freak, but I still had him in my dream.
Are they sexual dreams?
They get to be. They don't go as far as intercourse, but they get to be, you know, as close as they can possibly get to.
Let me first just clarify the sexual dream part that Drew asked. All young men, when they dream, their sexual dreams, hence the morning wood.
No matter what the dream is.
No matter what it is. I could fall asleep with the nightline on. Boom. As soon as I went under, it'd be me and Ted Koppel just rolling around somewhere.
We all have at some point.
With the rug or without?
I'm wearing the rug.
All right.
All right, so, Tom, and is this, does this worry you?
It does in a way. You know, in my mind, I don't necessarily want to be gay at all. I don't want to be bi, you know. I don't want to have anything to do with men other than friendship when I'm awake. And I'm worried that maybe, you know, this is going to, you know, get into my subconscious or something. I'm going to walk by a guy and say, hey, nice ass.
No, Tom, look. may have some level of desire towards men that you have difficulty dealing with or really letting into your consciousness. But that just having those feelings doesn't mean you're going to choose a gay lifestyle or somehow these feelings are going to take over and you're going to become compulsively preoccupied with men in a way that you find totally unpleasant. It's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen that way. I mean, you've got to examine your feelings and look at where these are coming from. We don't know enough about you to know what's happening here. But this does not mean you're suddenly going to become gay. It just doesn't mean that.
No,
okay?
It could take 3 or 4 weeks, oftentimes. I think, first off, I could figure it out if you just let me in his room and let me examine the sock and underwear drawer.
Oh, really?
Yes, the things are laid out nicely, and the socks are bundled beautifully. Nice. That is a tip-off.
Can I say one thing to Tom?
Yes.
Man, that's your subconscious. It's already in your subconscious. Your subconscious is just this weird tape that plays things that you pick up, and you might have feelings. It's like Drew says, you don't have to act on them. You have a decision in your conscious life what to make on it. My subconscious is where I get my songs from, basically. You know, I think about something. Don't freak out on it. If you meet a guy down
there, they're solid. Very solid.
But I'm guessing the Village People, where they got their... See, when they were thinking about the songs, okay.
You were the Indian.
I was a construction guy. All right. Speaking of songs, forget about all the music. You guys are done talking about that. All right, you got yourself a beautiful house.
Yes, I do. I have two of them.
Oh, yeah. Are they both in Oregon?
Yeah. Well, yeah. What do you think they're going to be? Latvia?
And you've got a 4-year-old daughter.
I don't know.
I have a 4.5-year-old daughter.
4.5-year-old?
Yeah. And she's doing well. She misses her daddy. I'm going to go see her.
It's got to be tough. You would travel a lot.
Well, I've been traveling a lot. Now I've been home for, we were home for a couple of weeks working on the new record. We came off tour from Australia. This kid was in the hospital with pneumonia 2 days after he got home.
Wow. We've just been nonstop for the last 2.5 years touring. It's just
I had walking pneumonia. He has brain cloud.
Yeah, it's real
bad.
Brain cloud.
Real bad.
It's really, it's disastrous.
The doctor's like, you ever see Joe versus
No, Volcano? Brain cloud. Come on.
No. Never mind. Man. But it's really bad. We're just emotionally kind of drained, but we wanted to make this record, so I got 2 more weeks down here, and then we're home for a while, a couple months.
And so everyone's in Portland, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, Greg and Craig, and you guys got...
I'm leaving.
Oh, you're moving?
I'm leaving us.
Yeah.
Where are you? San Francisco.
Going to San Francisco.
Oh, that's
Live
nice.
With my girlfriend, mm-hmm. who hasn't seen me in 2 years, so she's like, when are you getting down
two
here
years?
Now?
2 years, wow.
Yeah. Well, we've been on the road, so...
All right, so you finish up the record you're working on now, and then just take a break, and then just start the whole touring mess over again when that thing hits big.
I got like 3 bands to produce next year, so they're going to take time off. I'm going to take a little time off and then get to work.
Do you have a studio? You're going to put a studio in that big new house of yours?
No, we're working on a studio in Portland, actually. But I'm an A&R guy for Capitol as well, so I sign bands. So
oh, really?
I'm a busy guy.
I don't know... I talked to
I've heard
you
tape. I've heard you
tape. I sent the demo. I thought,
it's not going to work.
Oh.
It was an image thing.
You like shenanigans?
Yes.
What kind of shenanigans? We want to know. You guys want to know what kind of shenanigans?
Oh, please.
Has he ever done it with a person?
Yes. Next week I'm thinking of actually experimenting having sex with another woman.
Really?
Yes.
It's a big step.
Yeah, so far I've just been playing it safe and doing it alone.
Big move.
Smart ass. Garen, Loveline audience, what is your question?
Yeah, hi. I'm also a recovering addict and of about a year now sober.
Great.
And it's thanks a lot. Yeah, but my question was, in my, birth of sobriety or whatever, had quite a bit of trouble. I know if you don't have much money, okay, you don't usually have too much of a problem, but you get it either way. But I was wondering, your temptation's on the road, and now having probably a little more of a means, that's always been kind of a thing. You got access.
How does he maintain his sobriety with the lack of structure in his life, traveling all the time?
Right.
And now that you have money, that could be a trigger for you, too.
Sure.
I've
been a musician on the road, too. I've done my fair share of some stuff. Striving.
Those are good questions. And you know as well as I do, you don't really need money to get high, man. There's always ways to get high. And the sad thing about it is that when you don't have anything, no one gives you anything. And when you've got the money to pay for it, people are constantly trying to give you stuff. And we have a real strict thing. None of us do drugs. These guys drink moderately. They don't have a problem that I do. I can be around people that drink. It doesn't bother me. As a musician, man, as you build a band around you or a crew or whatever it is, keep in mind, don't bring people who do drugs into it. We're very adamant about that. People who smoke pot, people that do coke, and definitely people that shoot dope are not, we just don't hire them. It just doesn't work like that. And when we were headlining a gig like this, we did the Summerland tour, there was some bands on it that got a little miffed at it, but we didn't allow drugs backstage. You want to do drugs? Do it on your butt.
Thanks, Grant. Thanks so much. Thanks so much. Now, we've got Joe, line 8. Joe.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
Hey, my question is, my girlfriend's 24. We've been together for about 10 years. We see in the magazines how they have, like, creams that prolong erections. We want to know if that stuff really works and if it's safe to use.
Yes, the dong-hardening catalyst. I have a vat of it in my dressing room. We will get to this question after this and after this video. Tickets to come see us live. I don't blame you. Drew, how they do it?
You can be part of the Loveline studio audience by calling for tickets at 213-896-3035. 896-3035.
Alrighty, back with our good friends Everclear and Dr. Drew. And when we left off here on Loveline, we were speaking to Joe on the phone, who was asking about spreading some sort of ointment on his jewels so that he may cut glass with them. You want to know if this stuff works?
Yeah.
No.
Wait a minute now, Drew. Let's not be so hasty. You're talking about this stuff that's advertised in the back of the gentlemen's magazines?
Exactly, yeah. It seems like it's a put-on to me, but, I mean, you know, we might as well find out, right?
How much is it?
How much is it? I don't know. I didn't really look at the price or anything like that.
But it's what, 19?
Something like 20, 25 bucks.
All right.
Like that, probably.
There's your answer. If the stuff worked, it would cost $7,000 an ounce.
There are numbing creams that are available that may have limited something, and people claim they get some effect from, but it's basically a sham.
But I'll tell you, you rub enough of it on there for long enough, and you got yourself an erection.
You got yourself a party.
Parting a char. Dan is, because he wishes to remain anonymous, is at the Loveline Bar. Dan?
How you doing?
Good. What's your question?
Well, I was alone at the beach with a beautiful girl, and she made a move, and I freaked out, and I backed away, and I don't know what to do. I think because I've just been afraid of rejection, or I've always been taught to respect women, and I don't know if I should make that move, whether I go too far, or cross that boundary. What should I do? Because I wanted to make that move.
Hyperbole by Dan.
Yeah, make sure no sand gets caught up there.
Wait a minute. What? Is what's bothering you that the girl was too aggressive towards you?
She was too aggressive, but I wanted every piece of that action.
But because you weren't used to a woman being assertive, you got scared.
You
were frightened, and you backed away, right?
Absolutely.
And let me backtrack for a second. Did you meet her? Did she approach you while you're just lying there on the beach?
No, I've known her. I've known her.
So you went to the beach with her.
Yes.
It's just she was assertive, and I guess you said somebody in your family taught you that you should always be.
I should always respect women. 100%.
Well,
part of respecting women is satisfying a woman.
Ladies and gentlemen, mutuality in a relationship is part of respecting another person, understanding that that person has needs, and that person is certainly welcome to assert them if they wish, and you're eligible to either deflect them or accept them. That's respecting another person. Mutuality in a relationship. Respect doesn't mean passivity, okay? Women should learn to assert their needs. We don't teach women to do that. And then we teach men to to reject them when they do. It's a bad precedent.
To be Neanderthals. You know, the whole boy-girl thing doesn't get any easier as you get older. I'm in my 30s, man. It's still not getting any easier. And, you know, I've been in a committed relationship for years now. So just don't worry about it. If you made a mistake, go to her, man. Just call her. Try to make it work. Make it happen.
We agree.
Yes. Show up at the house with some cab on and ask to rub her down.
We got Sally on the phone. Sally.
You're from the 70s.
Hey. How you guys doing?
Good.
Great. I have a probably a strange question, but I'm going to go ahead and ask it anyway.
Tonight, whatever.
This is my first lesbian relationship I've ever been in. And unfortunately, it kind of got off to a rocky start because I was at work one day, and my girlfriend had called me, and we had been involved for probably about 2 weeks at this time. And she had called me and said we needed to talk, and unfortunately, I was working at a movie theater. I couldn't talk to her. I said, look, I'll try and call you back before I get off. Well, I didn't get a chance to call her back. And I got home, and she had this really, really, really weird look on her face. And I knew by the look on her face that I just knew something wasn't right, and I asked her, I said, you slept with your ex-husband, didn't you? And she had said yes. And I had gotten really, really upset about it. And ever since then, I've had a really hard time holding down a job. And I'm wondering if I'm ever going to get over this kind of, like, I don't really want to call it an insecurity, because when I'm around her, I know she's not going to sleep with someone else. It's just when I'm not there, I'm kind of wondering what's going on.
But you're still in this relationship.
Right.
Okay. And you equate going to work with her having sex with her ex.
Yeah, kind of, sort of.
Have you been getting depressed, too?
Yeah.
You're working at a theater?
I was. Oh. I was working at a movie theater, and I've been kind of in and out of jobs ever since.
Right.
I haven't really stuck around very long because it's like I'll be there for a week, and then all of a sudden I just want to stay home.
Yeah, Sally, this is unfortunately is terribly unhealthy, this kind of clinging that you're doing to this relationship,
uh-huh.
The insecurity you're feeling in the relationship, the depression you're feeling as you approach even a threat of abandonment.
I get depressed when I think about working, too, though.
But I don't think that it's about work. I think it's about how you, Sally, conduct yourself in relationships. And I would really consider some professional help with this, frankly. I mean,
totally.
This is probably going to destruct in some way, Sally, by being overly clingy, by being overly demanding on your partner to fulfill this sort of fantasy need you have. And also there are realistic issues here that she might leave you. She hasn't proven herself to be totally trustworthy.
Right.
And I don't think this is going to be sorted out between you. This is something you have to sort in yourself.
In myself, right.
Yeah, and I know I'm jumping to sort of professional intervention awfully quickly here, but this is sort of a classic situation that responds well to therapy, and you ought to think about getting some professional.
I have a quick question for Sally. Would it be worse in your mind if she had an affair with a woman or with a man like her ex-husband?
To be honest, either one. To me, cheating on me is cheating on me.
Okay.
It's about her being abandoned.
It's about trust.
It's about trusting that she won't leave.
Exactly.
And the weird thing is, I haven't, in previous relationships, only one person has cheated on me, and when they did, it didn't affect me. I was just like, you know, well, forget you.
Were you involved in that relationship, though, really?
I had dated him for about 5 years.
Doesn't matter. Did you feel for that guy what you feel for this woman?
No.
There you go. I have never had
feelings for any people that I've dated that I have now.
Well, there you go. And the consequence is you're having real trouble coping with it. It's
right.
Good that you're having intimacy, but now you're not able to cope with it, manage it. You get some help.
All right. And don't cling too much, because that'll drive the thing you love the most away from you. I guess you know that. All right, Sally. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, guys.
That was really special.
I was remembering an old REO Speedwagon song.
You can't tune a piano, but you can tune a fish. Is that the one?
And now we're going out to Chris. Help us, Chris.
Hey, guys. I'm out here in Las Vegas with Trisha, 22, and she's all the way from Vermont. She has a question for you guys.
My question is, I was thinking about getting breast implants, and I was wondering what the health consequences were.
I told her no, but go ahead, Drew.
Your boyfriend could smile so hard his face could actually freeze in that position, and he could have some sort of seizure,
We will deal with this question in a more responsible way after the break.
All right.
Yeah. 213-520-LOVE. The number is 213-520-LOVE.
Back with Greg, Craig, and Art, collectively Everclear, and Dr. Drew, collectively Dr. Drew. Now, when we left off, we were talking to Chris, who's in Vegas at the Hard Rock there. Chris?
I'm still here with Trisha.
All right, now Trisha's question was regarding breast implants.
That's right.
Right. I mean, first of all, it's a surgery, right, getting those implants in, and obviously the risks of anesthesia, infection, bleeding, this sort of thing that comes along with any surgery. I'm sure most people are aware of the controversy surrounding the silicone implants. So these days, it's saline implants that are put in. There are health risks associated with the surgery. The implants, once they're in, usually don't have any significant problems other than complications of the implant themselves. They can scar, they can encapsulate, you can get infection in them, this sort of thing. I mean, it's a medical procedure. People need to understand that.
Why do you want to get them, Trisha?
Why? Because I think I'm too small.
She's fabulous. You should see them.
You look awesome.
So, you know, my favorite part about that is Chris takes the microphone and goes, "You should see them."
You should hear them talk too, Adam.
My thing on them has always been is just like they look better with clothes on them than they do off. They look fake. They're not real. What are you gonna do with them in 5 years? Is that enough to work?
I need a little something more.
You know, you've got everything you need. Don't worry about that. It's
thanks.
You should. Are you with? Do you have a boyfriend now?
No, I don't.
Don't worry about it.
Adam,
I'm down. Do you want a boyfriend?
I'm married. How about
I'm
you,
looking.
Adam?
Listen, I'll pay for one of them. The way I figure it's just, you know, I always sleep on the right side of the bed, so if we just get the left one done, I...
Okay. Trish, everybody's telling you the same thing.
Is don't
that,
do it.
Yeah, don't do it.
Get out of Vegas.
Be comfortable with who you are, how you look.
She's in
focus more on finding somebody that cares about you as a person, and you'll probably be happy in your relationships anyway than attracting somebody who's attracted to this...
All right, Trish, I'm saying start saving. All right, thank you very much. Drew will not rest until he can talk every woman out of having sex and every woman from not having breast augmentation. What else, Drew?
You don't want women to have sex?
What?
He doesn't want women to have sex. I am
on a crusade against people having sex
stupidly.
And without emotional meaning by it, without reason for it.
I was gonna say something to that one girl was like, "Well, I had a party at my house. I met a guy, I slept with him. Do you think he was offended that I shaved myself?" Maybe he slept with you, and it was just, you know, there was nothing there. It was just so easy. It's just there was no intimacy.
Exactly.
You can have sex without intimacy. Who
people
needs
do it all
it?
The time, but who needs it exactly?
Who needs it?
All right, I'm losing my wood now. So let's move on.
Let's go to Kamisha in the audience.
Kamisha?
Hi.
Hey.
In all my past few relationships, my guys kind of approached me and they wanted me to do a striptease act. I felt that it was really degrading and I felt really uncomfortable. And I'm wondering, what's the fascination that guys have with women taking their clothes off? And do you think I should have done it?
All right, here's the fascination. When you're done, you're naked.
That's the most obvious.
Well, if you want to do it out in the hall, most guys will be okay with that. But seriously, guys enjoy the titillation of that, seeing the layers come back. It's like peeling back a beautiful onion to find a...
You're on a roll.
I was until I started thinking.
That way we don't have to do anything.
Did you do this thing?
No.
And what you're saying is, what is it that he needs this bizarre ritual that he can't just accept me for who I am and think about being intimate with me, right?
Right.
The guys do these weird things, and women have a hard time understanding what could be so exciting about these visual, physical aspects of things.
What is wrong with fantasy, Drew?
It's just a fantasy.
Why should women wear makeup in that case? Why put on that beautiful skirt you're wearing, or the vest? Why the high heels? Why the red lipstick? All part of life's rich pageantry, which involves stripping, I say.
Chris, are you there? Chris in Vegas. Chris?
Lisa, have you asked him to strip for you yet?
Yes, I have. He wouldn't.
He wouldn't?
Yeah. No.
Well, there you go. What a pig.
I mean, there's nothing pretty about a guy stripping. He's got the pants. He's trying to pull the pants over the shoes.
I'm waiting,
and Brody's and knocks over the nightstand. It's not pretty at all.
Show him, buddy.
Adam, strip for me.
He does a really good strip.
Buddy is hot.
All right, Lisa, listen, I think you're perfectly appropriate saying no, and I think you need to get him to be more respectful of you and acknowledge your real feelings. And maybe then, if you're getting sort of more empathic kinds of input from him, you won't mind doing these little fancies he asked for.
All right, or tell him to start tipping. Right, Drew?
Yeah, right. Oh, yeah.
Just about does it. So I want to thank Everclear for coming out tonight. The CD's called Sparkle and Fade. The new CD will be out soon enough if you want to find the guys that will be convalescing in Portland. Also, Chris from Vegas, thank you.
Hey guys, thank you so much. Good night.
And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Loveline takes desperation out of the equation for the holidays when it returns tomorrow night at midnight. On the way, the queen of all that is real and good and true in music today. Keep it here for Kennedy and MTV's Alternative Nation coming up next.